hindsight, the disintegration of the Verve was always on the cards. 4 years of decadence, drug abuse, ego clashes, and great music. They even seemed to tee up their own demise with the fatalistic words on their last single, History. All farewells should be sudden. They were right. By the time History was released, the Verve had split.
Join a band when you're boys, and by the time you turned into young men, I think things change in your life, and I think that's the problem that bands find. It's the stuff that they bring in from the outside world back into the band that becomes difficult to deal with, so we just needed a bit of time away to remember what it was about in the first place. And sometimes when your problems are so much, you start abusing your muse, you start abusing the band, you start abusing the power of the group. And we put it into perspective that the band's bigger than us. I mean, so many bands would have carried on for, I don't know, commercial reasons or fear that if they weren't in a band, they wouldn't be able to do anything or anything else. And I think that gives you a certain sense of, I don't know, it just gives you a slap in the face and says, yeah, I can actually walk out of this if I want to. I don't necessarily have to be in this band for another 20 years if it's causing me pain. If I'm buzzing off and I'm getting something out of it, then yeah, I'll be in this band.
The central problem with the Verve was a classic one, the relationship between the frontman, Richard Ashcroft, and the lead guitarist, Nick McCabe. Within 2 weeks of the split, the old Verve were back in the studio, minus Nick. But it was soon clear that it wasn't going to work without him and his unique guitar sound.
When you've played in the same band as four musicians over the years, when you're writing a song, you tend to hear the way they play in your head. So if I'm hearing bass, I hear Simon the way Simon Jones plays bass. Or I hear Nick McCabe on guitar, or I hear Pete on drums, you see. That's the way I hear it in my head. And now you take one piece of the pie away and it falls flat on its face. So I don't think I ever would have gone off and done a solo thing. I think I would have probably just got a plane to Acapulco and, you know, sold watches on the beach or something. I don't know, I just would have done something different, because unless it's the best, it ain't good enough.
After 18 months apart, Richard Ashcroft knew the Verve would only work in its original form. They just needed time and space away. So, totally out of the blue, Richard phoned Nick for the first time since the split, and in February 1996, the Verve reformed.
Instinctively, in these kind of situations, you know when the time's right, and we needed that space for wounds to heal or whatever, and it was the right time, because within a week we were in the studio and we were making Urban Hymns, and everything was smoother than it had been at any time before, because independently of each other we'd all work things out.
Now that the group were back on track, Richard's early predictions were beginning to come true. For the Verve Mark II, there was only one choice for their first commercial release. On the 16th of June 1997, Bittersweet Symphony hit the streets.
Such a mind-blowing piece of music. It didn't sound like anything else. You know, we were just building this wall, great wall of sound. We were bringing in our hip-hop, what we'd learned from hip-hop, and making a kind of modern-day blues record. Almost like what Gram Parsons dreamt about in the 70s, this kind of immense boiling pot of different forms of music which you can tap into, and we were lucky in 1997 to be able to have that behind us. But instead of just picking certain points of it, you put it all into the stew, and what comes out hopefully is something that sounds fresh and a bit more vital. And I think Bittersweet Symphony sort of sums that kind of attitude up. No change, I can change, I can change, I can change, but I'm here in my mold, I am here in my mold, but I'm a a kind of video that is easy to watch and just burns and runs right over your head. And it was important to get a different side of life and a different attitude back on the screen again. And I think that's why people connected with that video, because, and the song together, because it creates one soul, one image, and it's something people can almost relate to. I don't know, it just has a power about it. Because at the end of the day, I was walking down the street 400 times in the East End of London for 2 days. It's like, what are you going to look like? You're not going to look like Mary Poppins, are you? You know what I mean?
The Verve story so far had been a bittersweet symphony. The triumph of the Verve's comeback anthem was typically undercut by a legal wrangle. A Rolling Stones string sample, which forms the hook of the song, saw them lose every penny of royalties.
We were just obviously taking on board technology and embracing it. But in the end, it's not in the Stones' hands, it's in the hand of some guy in a suit in New York City who owns their material. Now, none of these people need any more money. I'm sure they have excessive amounts of money. But the way I see it now, it's a bit clearer in my head. It's more like a KLF kind of thing. The KLF couldn't have dreamed up a scam like this. The Bittersweet Symphony, you're a slave to money, then you die. Then some geezer comes and takes all the publishing from it. It's sort of beautiful. And there's no time anymore for me to be bitter about it. You know what I mean? I've smashed a few doors over it. I've done the karate kicks. I've screamed till the veins are coming out of here when I first heard about it. But there's no time now. I've done all that and I'm moving on. And a lot of people said, you know, I can't believe you actually put it on the album. But I'm glad you put it on the album. But there was never, I mean, I even knew that we may have the whole publishing taken away from us before we even put it on as a single. But what's important is when you're building a wall of sound like Bittersweet Symphony, if you take one thing out of it, then it isn't the same, because music's about other music hitting each other, which makes other sounds. So I was in a position where if I took it out, even though it's subliminal, it's subliminal can be important. So I was in a no-win situation, and the song deserved to be heard at the end of the day. The song's bigger than me, bigger than the band. The song's for the people. It's not, you know what I mean? It's not about keeping things back because you're not going to make £1 million. It's about you've made this amazing thing. Yeah, you've been ripped off, but it's going to open a lot of doors for us in the future, so sod it. Drugs Don't Work was written as a love song, but as far as interpretation goes, I think, yeah, I've had to deal with those things in my life, but I don't think the listener or the fan needs to know anything more than the song, because we always abuse our listeners' imaginations and the viewers' imaginations by giving them too much and telling them too much, you know? We're making music, we're not making cheeseburgers, so I'm not about to give it them on a plate and say what exactly it's about. And I think that's important. I hate it when I see lead singers taking all the mystery away. It's like, for 10 years you might have thought the way a song was meant to be in your own imagination, and it might have been all fine and you had it all sorted in your head, and then some geezer comes along and tells you that it was completely different and shatters the dream. Spoke to people who've got nothing to do with the critical side of this business. I've spoken to people, the critic side of the business, sorry. I've spoken to people in pubs, I've spoken to people on the street who weren't even aware of the Verve Worth 6 months ago, but something connected with them, with Bittersweet Symphony and the Drugs Don't Work, that they can't explain. You know, sometimes music touches you and you can't deny it. So I'm not too interested in what the critics say. I'm interested in how music can still have a power and can still affect people and can still move people. But at the end of the day, you know, we're better than what the critics say. Music is beyond numbers at the end of a page. Music is beyond anyone's analysis in a room with a stereo. Music lives beyond these parameters, so I wouldn't be arrogant to say that we're better than that. this band's always put an immense amount of pressure on itself. Like, if you set your sights, if you're a... You see, when you come out of the north of England and you start your band, it's almost like the world isn't listening. So for the world to listen, you take a Muhammad Ali stance and you start boxing the world, you start telling the world how great you are, blah, blah, blah. And it seems to be a habit of us northern groups to have to tell the world how good we are. So you go through that whole process, banging on people's heads to get there. And by doing that, you build yourself up. And by building yourself up, you have to live up to it. And like, a lot of bands don't live up to it, but, you know, when you do actually live up to it and probably go beyond expectations, that's when it becomes exciting.
History has a place for us. It may take us three albums, but we will be there. 4 years later, on the eve of the Verve's third album, Urban Hymns, released on the 29th of September 1997, it seemed this prediction was about to come gloriously true.
I was talking to Simon the other day, and basically we can all gain strength from the fact that every record we've ever done, all we know is we put everything into it, and you can't give more than that. So our own expectations are very high, so I never thought or worried about anyone else. We've never made music for anyone else. It's for everyone once it's finished and once it's out on the radio or once it's out on MTV. It's other people's music then. But once you're making it, it's your own, and it's your own. You're turning yourself on, no one else. If you can't turn yourself on in the studio, then you're not going to do it to anyone else because you're the judge.
Tell me what you've seen. Was it a dream? Was I in it? Life seems so obscene until it's over. Who knows? All I want is someone who can fill the hole in the
last few years to be able to open up myself, to be able to take the baggage off my shoulders, which enables you to sing about stuff that is real. I mean, at first when I started, I used a lot of imagery in my lyrics basically to hide a lot of things, and it was effective in the music it was surrounded in then. But then when I got to a Northern Soul and songs like On Your Own and History, you get to a point in your life where you think, I'm not going to hide anymore. And when you don't hide, you say what you really feel, and when you say what you really feel, sometimes it connects with other people because we're all in this madhouse together. And sometimes, you know, songs connect with us and become a soundtrack to life.
Oasis and The Verve, two bands certain of each other's status as best bands in the world, self-belief and northern roots threw them together, not apart.
Well, if I look back 3 years ago when we were playing together, we were playing in front of 200, 300 people. And like I said before, with that kind of northern attitude, we were obviously building and buoying each other up, saying, you know, we will make it happen. You know, I saw Live Forever performed in front of three people in Bradford, and they saw us play in front of 200. Now, take that forward a few years and, you know, the Verve and Oasis had an album at number one, a single number one. And I think also they need someone else up there with them, because they've been out there on their own for too long without someone meaty enough to be up there with them. Do you know what I mean? It's like, I think it's pretty lonely when you're out on the top on your own, whereas in the 60s the Beatles had the Stones, or they had some other various artists, American bands, who were all on something together. When he said bound with all the weight of the words he tried to say, now having Urban Hymns out, he now knows that I ain't bound with all the weight of all the words I tried to say. Sometimes you're getting them out. But I think that's a song for everyone. I don't necessarily think it's just for me, because it is, without a doubt, one of the best songs he's ever written. In my book, maybe I'm a bit biased, but you can't be anything other than honoured, because he's a great songwriter, amazing songwriter.
Now in full flow, the Verve began performing live again, and after 18 months away, it was clear that the Verve supporters and thousands of new ones were keen to hear their new material.
There's people who had a Northern Soul for 2 years and were... I mean, I've never heard our songs actually sang back. I mean, I've never even had that experience, and that sort of took my breath away on the first night. It's like everyone knew the words. Whereas people before, they were still in the point, we had fans, but yeah, Northern Soul hadn't been out long enough for people to even get in it on a real level. So, you know, it was madness, absolute madness. Amazing. A real buzz. I mean, people have been waiting for so long to get in there and have it. And anyone who's seen us before know it's, we know it, they know it's a rock and roll show, that it's not just your average band, this is the Verve, man. And they had tickets for it. And I knew that, and they know I know it.
Urban Hymns has been tagged the best album of 1997 by many critics, and is widely regarded as the most definitive comeback in British music history.
You know, Urban Hymns is a mixture of all the ingredients that we love to listen to ourselves. You know, you'll hear Marvin Gaye in Urban Hymns, you'll hear Led Zeppelin, you'll hear hip-hop, you'll hear country music, you'll hear serious blues. It's a big mix, but what happens is when you put the voice over it, and my voice, it becomes one soul, and it doesn't confuse you. It becomes one thing. So it's emotional music. At times it's heavy music, at times it's joyous music. It's what an album should be about, really, as far as I'm concerned. All kinds of emotions. We're still learning, we're still getting better. But I always knew there'd come a time when people would tune into the Verve and realise how important this band is. But sometimes you have to wait, and sometimes you have to realise that the world's run by chaos, and we don't have that much control, really. So things are going to happen along the way that may take a little bit longer. But if it takes a bit longer, that means that your foundations are stronger.
But the question everyone is asking is, are the Verve back for good, and is the best yet to come?
It continues. I mean, again, I can't be a believer in chaos and then predict how long we're going to last. I really don't know. I mean, we hope now that we're tight enough to keep it going for a good few years yet. I think we haven't satisfied our hunger to make, we've not made enough records yet, basically. And I think that's what we're really going to concentrate on, although we won't ignore the life side of it. But we don't want to kill ourselves, and we don't want to go down the roads we went before, where we were unable to record or think about writing music because we've been out on the road too long. I think a lot of bands suffer from that. So as long as you get everything in perspective and start organising it so you can create, then I see it going on for a long time, and I see the records getting stronger and stronger, because like I said before, it's the late 90s now, and rock and roll to survive has to be beyond the average. It has to strive to be bigger than dance music, taking dance music, taking whatever we want, to form a new kind of music, a music that's unheard of yet. And that's what Urban Hymns is striving for. And we'll keep on doing that like we always have.